Yeah, that's about you. So I didn't really prepare this because I wanted to prepare in the past few minutes slash hours, and now I was stuck with the error you're having. But let me share my screen. Oh, that's my entire screen. Okay, so first of all, just one second in here. So, what I will do eventually, so the problem we're having right now is that, so if you didn't pull, if you pulled after yesterday evening, the problem we're gonna have is that, well, first, if you do accept the homework, so if you click on this link, it will take, no, you don't see that screen. But it will take forever to import. It will say creating your repository forever, and that won't work. But it will be created in the meantime under the standard link 2020 minus homework or 7 minus your GitHub username. But then it will be empty, and that's bad. That's if you change something on GitHub Classroom after we publish the homework and I did change something. So what I'm going to do to fix that is that in the dashboard, so I shouldn't show this works better, never mind. That in the dashboard, there will be a link here right next to current homework, which you can click, which will add all the necessary files to the homework, to the current homework, and will be the link to your repository. So once you have to click this link once, and then you will have the correct files in the homework. So this doesn't work right now because I'm busy implementing it. I was busy for the past 3 hours, but I didn't get it done yet. But I will in hopefully like 20 minutes. All right, now regarding the homework. So I will open that now in PyCharm because I can now presuppose PyCharm, which is nice, and I can open stuff in the debugger, which I really, really like. Yeah, so let's start with not this, but homework R7. So this is your homework. Let's look at the README. Yeah, you've already seen the Pokemon data set. However, it's no not Pokemon, but it's called Pokemon Edited because I changed a few things there. I removed the duplicates, for example. And through other, well, results from a study which I conducted as HIVI a couple of years ago. And I think so they can be considered typical for experiment data, and I wanted you to have some kind of experiment data. But yeah, so first of all, these experiment data thingies. Let's look at them. Let's look at them in a nice way. Can I open CSV files in PyCharm privately? I'm 100% sure I can do, but I'm not sure how to right now. Do I have the CSV plugin? Never mind, let's. Oh no, you can't see it if I don't open it in PyCharm. Okay, then I'm gonna do what I wanted to do anyway, and that is show you how it looks in the debugger because that's really nice. So, let me. So this is the file which you're working on, and how I always work on that kind of stuff. I always go into the debugger, and then now, at some point where, for example, I loaded this, oops, I can. I also have to share my entire screen because you can't see the windows I'm opening. Okay, one second. Okay, now you're seeing two screens, right? That sucks. A bit of stuff. Let's go on my room. Okay, can you still hear me? Because I think I lost internet in the meantime. I normally open these files in the debugger, and now I can, well, I can look at my exp data, which is the loaded CSV, and I can in PyCharm nicely view as data frame. That's really nice for pandas data frames. I can also view NumPy arrays as NumPy array. Now we have this nice sky view, which will show me the entire thing as data frame. Alright, so what do we have here? So we have these columns and these indices. So there's a subject ID, which seems to be the same one for all columns. We have some kind of list. I forgot myself what that was. We have some kind of toggle, which doesn't monotonically increase, so I have no clue what this is, and neither do you need to. We have the important column reading response time. This is what we're going to average over in the end. We have the sentence num. We have apparently different experiments. We have apparently some kind of Boolean variable as practice here. So it's either 1 or 0, which means that it being Boolean. Item number, condition, order index, answer if it's prediction, prediction 1 and prediction 2. So what I say, what you always should do first, not this, that's the weak thing, is to always look at some of this data set. So we can look at the columns, at the head, at the describe, etc. So let's do that. Let's call expdata.columns, whenever we looked at them. So these here are the columns we have subject ID, etc., etc. So most of these are not important for you, but we know we have this reading response time and for example, where if it's practice. Okay, we can call expdata.describe. Describe. And so if you now view this as data frame, PyCharm doesn't want me to. Well, that sucks a bit. Yeah, sometimes, I think it's the recent PyCharm version which has problems with viewing some data frames, but if I would update, won't be that much of a problem. So what I can do, I can simply print it. It's not as pretty as a Jupyter then, but it's gonna be fine. So describe. So let's put that afterward here. Yes, that one's not printed yet. Alright, so this is the describe function. It doesn't print it nicely, but I see that, for example, when I have Fitz prediction, I don't have, so normally I seem to have 234 rows here. But I see that the Fitz prediction doesn't have 234 rows, so I know there are a lot of missing values in Fitz prediction. And when looking at the data set, we're going to see that it's only for the third or the second sentence over the time. So I can open CSV just as well and Office or in Excel, and I'm seeing that this fit spread always only exists for sentence numbers 2 for the filler, 3 for experiment 2, and 2 for experiment 1. That's what I've got notes, I'm looking at it, etc. etc. So we have a good look at our data set using the stuff I described to you. And then, yeah, the question is, does the average reading time differ for the respective predictions? So, which one did I look at? Subject all. So this here is the one we're working in with in this task. And we have to consider only those rows of the experiment data which are not for practice and which have an answer. So if we're looking at this, we see that the is practice here is true for some of these columns. So we obviously have to filter these out and then and which have an answer. So what we're doing is, well, we only want the ones where answer exists and is not NaN, so only looking at the sentences I just saw, the sentence numbers I just told you. And then group by to create a hierarchical index. We had this in the, so the very, very last thing of this week's lecture, group by with a hierarchical index. You can simply pass two a list of two columns to group by, and it's going to form a hierarchical index automatically. And yeah, then as aggregation, we want to use mean as well as count of this column. So we use the dot agg and then provide a list where we want the mean and the count of only this reading response time column. And then yeah, then we would have a column more because we would have which experiment filler, and then fit spread would always be 0 because in the filler there's never the fit spread. Equals 1, it's always the 0th one, as there's only one condition for that, so we would drop the fit spread from here, and this is what we would stuck with. So filter out those ones which are for practice and those which don't have an answer, use group by to form a hierarchical index with these aggregation functions on this column, drop the filler row, and we're done. So I think I didn't tell you how to drop rows, but it's simply we can use pd.drop. So if I'm opening this again, what's this somewhere? So can go for exp data, and then I can simply call exp data.drop, and then as argument columns or rather rows equals, and then a list of rows I'm dropping. So when we're looking at exp data here again, now look at the row 7497. So the response time, and if we drop simply rows equals 0. Ah, it's not rows, and this time it's in this. I think it's index. And that's not a string, that's an int. Yeah. And now if we look at this again, we see that we drop the first. So this doesn't exist anymore. Yeah. So I hope that's relatively straightforward. Then the second real task concerns this data set. It's a tiny bit different, so there are only fillers here. And like I said, what you should be doing is you should look at the columns, at the details, at the head, go for describe or value counts. And then, yes, so what you're also supposed to be looking at is the read CSV method. So, which is, like I told you, a bunch of arguments. Because if you are simply reading like we were doing here, so imagine we would use this read CSV for such a filler view, we would have this data frame, which I again can't look at. That sounds kind of weird right now. But we're seeing that this would be the first entry and this would be the second cell, so first cell, second cell, and so on. So apparently, and as we see also if we're looking at it in text viewer, this doesn't use commas as separators but semicolons. And there's an argument here for what's going to be a separator, and so we have to use that argument and one or two more arguments. Alright. And then, read the answer correctly, we could also use the normal Boolean D-type from the answer correct column. And we want to use the stimuli index, columns index. And why that? That was already a question. So with the correct index, you can get those rows for which the column answer correct of the respective seventh sentence is true. So, let's look at this again in Excel. So only the respective seventh sentence, so this answer correct is only true for, can only be true or false for sentence number seven. But this entire block, so this is basically one trial, so as we see this here is one trial because well, trial number is one number. If we use stimuli index or trial number actually, what is a stimuli index? I could have used just as well the trial number as index. If we use this as index, well, I can simply, if I get all rows with index, for example, 49, I would get all of these seven rows because this is simply a property of pandas that if you have that you can have multiple values for the same index, and if you're then getting the index of the row where for sentence number equals 7 answer correct is true, then you're getting all of these 7 rows, which is what you want. This is just indexing, so you can simply use the dot log to get those rows where the index is, and then you have to specify the index. And thus you can get these 7 sentences. Okay. Was there anything here? Okay. We can have the practice shorter. I mean, if the practice is shorter, that's just me ending in 2 minutes and us not having time for questions. Okay, and then we're looking at the Pokemon dataset again. So, find the Pokemon with the best stats that can best defend the most common type combination there is. So, let's look at this in the debugger again. Let's comment all of that stuff out, and let's make a breakpoint. Let's say yes. So, I already provided you this template how I solved it. So I first set the type numbers, first figured out the type numbers with a group by, then I found the most common types of these type numbers, etc., 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 which is possible. You don't have to do it like that. Philip didn't do it like this, so at your liking. So let's look at these all Pokemon as a data frame, and we're seeing that they all have type 1 and type 2. I already merged them in such a way that the alphabetically first type is always first, so grass with a G is before poison and fire, or fire is before flying, even though this is, no wait, so in some cases, so for example, Pidgey is normally normal flying, but we sorted it that way such that you can simply get type 1, or so if you have a type combination, type 1 will always be the same one. So flying, normal and normal flying are the same Pokemon. And then, yeah, what you're supposed to do is figure out the most common type combination with the group by, and then use the other one, the effectivity attack data frame, oops, to figure out which are the best defenders against that. So this here is the attacker, I think, and this here is the defender, so to get the effectivity of defenders, we can simply transpose it. So cut that now this is the defender, this is the attacker. And if you get the, for example, if you wanted to figure out a Pokemon that is good at defending the flying type, I would go for this row and check where this value equals 0.5. And that's then a good defender. And then I would have to find all the types which are good defenders against the most common type. And the most common type is normal flying, I think. Or whether for our case it's flying normal. And then I would find those types that are the best against these, which are Steel and Rock, I think. Then I would find all Pokemon which have the type combination Steel and Rock. So all Pokemon here, and then I could simply go for all Pokemon at the position where all Pokemon type 1 equals Rock comes alphabetically before Steel. And what do I have to say? All Pokemon type 2 equals Tier. Also in parentheses. And this will give me a list of Pokemon. And then I'm simply looking at the highest total stats, and what I'm seeing here that there's Pokemon's Aggron. So you're supposed to return this Aggron here. It should be only these lines. You can do it another way, you can probably do it even shorter, but this is highlighted. And yes, I think this is all I have to say about that. Like I said, I didn't prepare this because I worked on the other stuff where in the time I wanted originally to prepare this. So if you have questions, go for questions. I can show you more stuff spontaneously. But yeah, that would be it for right now. So expect the fix for the homework in, let's say, an hour. So in an hour I would probably update the dashboard such that you can click this link on there, I hope. Fingers crossed. Yeah, so like I said, if you have anything which I'm supposed to show you, stuff from the lecture again, stuff from the homework, just randomly showing you around in the debugger again, for example, or in Pandas, I'm happy to. I just don't know what I would do right now, so I'm rely on your input. The notable boolean. So, what you can do, it's actually not even necessary, it's just what you can do, but if you are reading, so let's go for, so let's, let me do another Python interpreter. So if I read CSV and then this subject filler view. Oh yeah, good call. So if I'm not sure what direction I'm currently in. So if I pd.read.csv and then subject filler new.csv,
We're next to the fact that there's no cheating, and I can't look at the patch on. Well, a little bit retorted, so obviously you have to set the step to semicolon instead of colon. Now it looks pretty. But if we look at the key types of that, key types, we see that answer correct key type is object. And if we look at tmp.value count, value counts, for series. Yes. But we see it is of type object, but we see it only contains truths and false. But we also see that it only contains a few truths and a few falses, and the row is actually much longer. So the length of this is a lot more. So we see there are truths, false, and NaNs. And this is why Pandas uses this object data type. However, and I unfortunately didn't talk about this in the lecture because I literally only figured it out afterwards, Pandas now has a new data type. So I told you that NumPy, that Pandas uses np.nan for missing values, and that thus all columns which have missing values are going to be of type float, because np.nan is a float. But they changed in Pandas 1.0. In Pandas 1.0, you now have the nullable data types, so nullable integers and nullable booleans. And this then is, so, and then this is precisely what we have in this situation. This is for columns which have truths, false, and NaNs. And this then simply, the nullable boolean type then simply has a clean logic for three values. This is how and not an XOR and so on work for these. And it's perfect for us because if we have this nullable D type, well, we can have the ends. We can have the truths, false, and NAs. And what we can simply do here is we can. Well, if we're looking at the read CSV, we see that we can provide D type, and D type can be a dictionary column name to type. So what we can do is we can say dtype equals and then we provide the dictionary that answer correct is supposed to be of type boolean. Now if we look at our tmp dot dtypes, we see that answer correct is not of this type boolean, and if we look at tmp answer correct, we're seeing that we now have this true, there's also false somewhere, and this na. And now if we look at this dot zero, this is now this na type, and this, like I said, it's so it's pd.na, and that's the new definition of and missing values for Pandas. So you can still use numpy.nan, and pd.na has the same properties as numpy.nan. So for example, pd.na, oh no, it doesn't actually. So because it has this clean logic, sorry, that was wrong, it doesn't have the same properties. So numpy.nan does not equal numpy.nan, that's a funny thing about that. But pd.na has this clean logic, and so if we combine an a and an a, that will stay an a. But that will lead to the fact that so they're still propagated. So if you're working with data frames in series and pandas, and so for example when you're adding two data frames and the one had a normal thing, so a normal value at the same index where the other had an NA, it's still gonna, so the NA is gonna propagate. So if I say p.na plus 1, it will stay p.na. Just like np.nan plus 1 will stay np.nan. So this is basically pandas now in their same, their own thing, and there's no new thing from sim values since pandas 1.0. Sorry, I'm not that used to pandas 1.0. I only upgraded really recently. And yeah, that's nice new features of pandas. But that's just all you need to do. So what you're supposed to do is literally this. I think those were all the arguments. So index calling always have separator and then it's dtype. But instead of doing that, you could also go for those rows where answer correct equals equals quotation mark true quotation mark. But this is the nicer, correcter way to do it. And also wanted simply to show you this new type, because I unfortunately didn't mention it. Alright.
Do you have something more to say about that? So,
oh yeah, and so I cannot in pandas, so if I have something like if pd.na do something, or rather, I don't know, let's do nothing here, that will raise me a type error because the boolean value of na is ambiguous. So pd.na.bool will give me the type error boolean value of an A is ambiguous. So what actually happens if I try the same for np.nan? I think it's considered false, is it? Ah, it's considered true. Okay, that's weird. But this has also some side effects, but it's what you actually want, because if you ever do that, you're in an undefined state, and this is what pandas literally tells you. Don't try to get the truth value. So the truth value of an A is some undefined thing. They also mentioned that somewhere here. Yeah, alright. Okay. And if you don't have any further things, I would say we're done. Then I would add this. Okay, that's it then. Bye bye.